just give myself hope that this is just a mountain that I have to climb, and I have to climb it for her. And I have already started preparing her now about this journey, because I know subconsciously she will know. And because you don't want her to wake up in the morning and find her scar on her chest and she starts screaming. So I always tell her, drink the medicine, because if you drink the medicine, your heart will be okay. We have to go to the hospital. You know, the doctor will cut here and fix your heart and you'll be a strong girl. She's not understanding what I'm saying, but it's just like preparation. I'm telling her we're going to board a plane. The mom is also missing. She's my daughter. She's also missing. She has been an on and off parent for Petra for a while. And she just speaks to Petra on the phone. Sometimes she come in, see Petra for 2 minutes and disappear again for another 2-3 weeks or so. So I've been trying to follow up for a while. Why are you running away from this girl? My name is Ruth Ngei and I'm 49 years old. I'm a mother of 4 girls. I'm also a grandmother of 3 granddaughters and 3 grandsons.
Mm-hmm. You're a mom of 4?
Yes, 4 girls.
And now grandsons, what? granddaughters.
Yes.
You look so young. get that a lot.
Yes, it's because of the fitness. Because of fitness and being able to eat the right foods and exercising and also having enough sleep also attributes to your body having enough collagen. Also, my youngest granddaughter Petra, I stay with her. I've been staying with her for the last 2 years, and Petra had been having a weight issue for a long time, and she used to wake up in the wee hours of the night, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, screaming. Screaming very loudly, and you try and soothe her. She would not hear unless you carry her on your chest and sing to her so that she can be able to sleep. So I used to wonder what kind of condition is this, that the child has low weight and waking up at the wee hours of the night screaming. And sometimes even in those nights when she was screaming, I would just find myself praying our Father's prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. I would just pray and pray and pray inside of my heart as I'm singing to her. And then she falls asleep. And then I say, okay, she has fallen asleep. Then I just thank God. I just say, thank you, Jesus. Then I also sleep. And you see, when I started sharing my fears to a few friends and some family members, I'm telling them about Petra screaming at night and her weight, her gain that is not happening. They're telling me, you know, this your grandchild is bewitched. Those screaming at night is those demons coming to attack her.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And when they were saying that, I would believe, because when she wakes up and screams like that, I would pray. In fact, that prayer would just come on its own. I believe that this could be something to do with those kinds of things.
So you also started believing your daughter was your granddaughter was bewitched.
Yes, I started believing, because even she was getting smaller and smaller. When we get to the nutrition offices, she was getting thinner and thinner. Her hair was bad. It was brown, like a kwachako person, you know. So I started believing that this could be true, and I don't know if that was a coincidence or what. I would always see movies would just come on my television. I don't know whether it was coincidence or it was also a message for me of how people are being delivered and these kinds of things. And then I would say, maybe this is true. Maybe Petra is bewitched. Maybe I should seek a man of God to help me to pray for Petra. Because if this is how it is, and then I tried also to talk to the mom, she's very evasive. You know, I'm saying, why is Pet always screaming? She always screams like that. I said, what do you mean she always screams like that? You mean you've been knowing she's screaming, then you've never done anything about it? I said, no, leave her. She always screams like that. She'll fall asleep. I said, so that means when she usually screams, it does not affect you. You just think it's normal for you.
Mm.
She says, you're asking, you're just repeating the same questions and I'm telling you the same thing.
Mm.
So I just stopped that, asking her those questions. And that also even made me now know that, yes, that even I think she also knows that this child is bewitched.
Mm.
So now that's when now I started now looking for men of God to pray for her.
Mm.
I started traveling. I started going from this church to that church, from this church to that church, and wondering what's happening, you know. And anybody who tell me that, no, me, I'm a man of God or a preacher, I don't care whether you're a bike person or you're a sweeper, where I just say, pray for me. You know, prayers, you cannot judge that this person cannot pray on that house. Just pray, especially for my granddaughter. Just pray for my granddaughter.
Mm.
So that's how it went on like that. And I think the last place I went was in November last year. I went to Uganda for prayers.
Mm.
A very famous man there, Prophet Kakande. Kakande Ministries, I went there. And now that was now towards the end of November. And then we came into December. And then January is when now we knew the problem.
What's wrong with Petra?
Okay, Petra has a, how do they call it? They call it congenital heart disease,
mm-hmm.
or defects, because she has two holes in her heart. One is a VSD and the other one is a PDA. The PDA is an artery that did not close from birth, and also the VSD is a hole that didn't close when the child was supposed to cry immediately after birth.
Mm-hmm.
So now these two conditions have forced the heart to overwork and caused the heart to enlarge. And after now the heart has also enlarged from these two defects, then they have brought another condition called pulmonary artery hypertension.
Mm-hmm.
And that is now the blood forcing itself in the small arteries that go through the lungs.
Mm-hmm.
Now, these two defects, the PDA and the VSD, can be closed in Kenya. We have all the settings and expertise. It is done, it has been done, and it is still being done.
Mm.
But now the issue is the pulmonary hypertension. A doctor said we don't have the setting here in Kenya to do the same. So after they sourced for the right hospital, they settled on Miot International Hospital.
Mm.
They said they have the right setting there.
Mm-hmm.
Because Miot International Hospital is mainly for cardiac, deals also with stroke and trauma.
Mm.
That's the specialty of that hospital.
Mm.
And they have a children's unit. The child has been seen by over 4 pediatrician cardiologists in Kenya. We have Dr. Lois Mutai
from which hospital?
Bagadhi Hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Njuguna Maina, Kenyatta Hospital. Dr. Chesire, she's also in Kenyatta Hospital. Dr. Naomi Gashara, we are now under Dr. Naomi Gashara and Dr. Chesira.
Mm.
Three of them are ladies and one is a gentleman.
Mm-hmm.
So all these doctors cannot be wrong.
Right now, what drugs is she currently under?
Okay, she's on three different types of drugs.
Mm-hmm.
Namely, one of them is this one.
Mm-hmm.
This is digoxin.
Yeah.
Digoxin is the heart drug,
yeah.
And it's among the most expensive among all of these.
Mm-hmm.
Digoxin helps in lowering her heart rate,
mm-hmm.
because with her heart condition, she had elevated heart rate. So this one helps in controlling her heart rate to bring it down to the normal beat.
Mm-hmm.
And it also helps to strengthen the heartbeat. It's the 2400.
Wow.
Mm, 2400. Now this one is 2 ml every day, mm. once a day,
mm.
so it goes for a month.
Okay.
Yes, mm-hmm. it goes for 1 month.
Yeah.
And then she's on this one is Laxin.
Mm-hmm.
is this laxing? No, this is aldolton.
Yes.
Aldolton. Mm-hmm. Aldolton removes the excessive waters in the organs in the body, the lungs, the liver, the kidneys, because the heart condition makes all the water retention in these places. That's why she was having the endless coughs that would change, would keep changing the syrups, but it's because of the waters that were in the lungs. Mm-hmm. So this one helps remove all the waters from the organs in her body.
Okay.
Even the heart sometimes can retain that the water. Mm-hmm. So this is what Aldolton does. She takes this one twice a day, 2.5 in the morning and 2.5 in the evening.
Mm-hmm. How much is this?
This one, we get with this one, they are formulated at Kenyatta Hospital.
Okay.
Yes, because we don't have them in syrup form, they're in tablet form.
Mm.
So Kenyatta Hospital formulates both of these drugs. They cost about 304 shillings for both of them.
Mm-hmm.
And they only last 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, they don't have any nguvu. We have to throw them away.
You have to throw them
away. Yeah, so we refill them every 2 weeks.
Oh, okay.
So the third one is laxin.
Mm.
Laxin is supposed to help her with the secretion so that she can susu a lot and poo a lot, or long call and short call a lot.
Mm.
Yes. The doctor told me it's good because, you know, I think I mentioned to you that she used to have a lot of constipation and all that. So this one has really helped.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And I can see here, these are her scans.
Yes.
These are the ones that, there was another one here. This one.
This is the first one and the second one.
Mm.
This one. This is the latest. This is the latest. This is the latest X-ray.
Mm.
This is the latest X-ray.
Mm-hmm.
It was done at Bagadi Hospital.
Mm.
You can see it's written up there, Bagadi Hospital, and then the child's name.
Yeah.
Now this is the first. This is the first X-ray that was that was done.
Mm-hmm.
If you look, even if you look at both of them, you will realize that this one, the first one, the heart was bigger, and this one, it has reduced kidogo.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at it well, you can see.
When you are doing all this because you are the grandmother, where is the mother
or the dad? The mother, I don't know about the father. I've never met the father, and I've really tried to look for him. And most of the people, when we try to look for him, we are either meeting dead ends. So when we got a contact number that may be the number of the father, when we try to call, we don't know whether we're talking to a con person or not, because we've never spoken to him and I've never seen him. Even if anybody would just come out right now and tell me I'm Petra's dad, then I would not have any reason to doubt him or to say, no, you're not, you see. So when I sought advice from the children's department, they told me legally, mtoto ni wa mama.
Where is the mom?
The mom is also missing. She's my daughter. She's also missing. She has been an on and off parent for Petra for a while. And she just speaks to Petra on the phone. Sometimes she come in, see Petra for 2 minutes and disappear again for another 2 or 3 weeks or so. So I've been trying to follow up for a while. Why are you running away from this girl?
So did she like drop her to you, and was she like take care of your child, or at what point take care of your grandchild, or at what point did you start like taking care of Petra?
Well, you know, she should come and say, oh, I have to go somewhere, just take care of Petra, I'll come for her tomorrow or the day after tomorrow. So I say, okay, no problem, and she's my grandchild, why would I refuse to stay with her? So every time I would stay with Petra, I would see some kind of change, like, you know, her skin color would be nice, she'll be sleeping well, and this constipation thing that her mom was always complaining, constipation, I would see the constipation is not happening too much, because I would feed her a lot of fruits and a lot of water. And then all of a sudden it came, okay, I'm coming back, until now she would not come back. A whole week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, I was like, so what's happening? Because I have things to do. When Hope is home from school,
the other sister.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Her younger, her auntie now, it would be easy for me. because I'd be able to do my things when Hope is here. But when Hope goes to school, it will be hard for me unless I look for a daycare where I would leave Petra.
And is Petra feeling the absence of the mother during this duration? And what?
No, she doesn't bother. When she sees her mom, she'll say hi. She calls her mom babe. So hi babe, how are you? She'll just play there a little bit, and she's more attached to Hope.
Mm-hmm. Of course, you before you even do all these things, you might require the permission of the mom or the dad.
Yes.
For you to even have Petra undergo any surgery. Have you reached out to your daughter, and what is she saying?
Yes, I've reached out to her, and I've told her that her signature is very important, especially for the operations. And, you know, before we do the open heart surgery, I told her the other procedures that have to be done, and there are, some of them are surgical. They will need their mother's signature before now they can come into the open heart surgery. So I told her about it, and she didn't seem to be too much bothered about it. So I seeked for advice, and we have a family lawyer who I consulted with, Mr. Kimani. He told me that you will need to go to the children's department to seek for advice. And from there, then now that's how we can come in. So I went to the children's department. I thought maybe if she's called by an authority, she will listen and say, okay, yes, I have to be there. So she was very evasive. She was giving different kinds of stories. And I'm saying, this is not about you. This is about Petra. We're talking about Petra. We need you there for the signature. Why are we forcing you? No, she said, no, you know, I need the second opinion. I said, okay, nobody's refusing about the second opinion. But we're talking about the signature when it comes to this time for the procedures. And then she was so evasive that the children's department just advised me that you should now go ahead and apply for guardianship. Because without that guardianship letter, even the airport here, I cannot pass.
Have you gotten it?
We are in the process of getting it.
But you believe you'll get
it? Yes, I will get it. The children's department gave me the go-ahead that I can apply for it. Because right now we are looking about a sick child, not about whether the mom wants or not. We have a kind of a special bond with Petra, because sometimes even you can just find, I'm just feeling low, I don't know what direction, I don't know where to start. Petra will come and jump on my shoulders and tells me, carry me.
Aww.
Let's go. And then I say, no, I'm tired. She said, no. And she refuses to come out from there. Even if I don't stand up, she'll just sit there. And then I sometimes want to get upset and tell her, come out of there, I'm so tired. Then I realize, you know, this is a form of someone trying to comfort you in their own way. So let me just relax. Yes.
What keeps you like strong? Because I know you have really low moments sometimes.
I think I wouldn't want anybody to give up on me either, too. Because some of these things are like experiences, even like when we are going to climb those mountains that we usually climb. Sometimes the steep is so. So the mountain is so steep that you feel like you just want to give up and go back down. Then you realize that you came here to conquer the mountain. And the joy of you conquering the mountain is better than you giving up. So each time I look at Petra and I see the challenge ahead of us, I always give myself hope that this is just a mountain that I have to climb. And I have to climb it for her. And I've already started preparing her now about this journey. Because I know subconsciously she will know. And because you don't want her to wake up in the morning and find her scar on her chest and she starts screaming. So I always tell her, drink the medicine, because if you drink the medicine, your heart will be okay. We have to go to the hospital. You know, the doctor will cut here and fix your heart and you'll be a strong girl. She's not understanding what I'm saying, but it's just like preparation. I'm telling her we're going to board a plane. You know, I tell her all those things. Every time I'm always teaching her, I'm always telling her to say namaste, you know, trying to teach us small English words, because you see, in this our neighborhood is just all Swahili. People just speak Swahili. so that she can understand that when we get there, when she starts hearing people speaking English,
she's, you know, not.
She, yes. Yes. And then we watch a lot of Z World, because that's where we are going. So she can get in familiarity of seeing those kind of people and how they dress. So she can know now, when we get there, you know, oh, this is something that she sees.
Yes.
It won't be also a shock to her. Yes.
Yeah, lovely.
Yes.
Yeah.
So this is all part of preparation. I also sing for her songs and encourage her. So I know that those songs, in case we get into any difficulty, because I know immediately after surgery, she's going to be in the ICU for a day or two before she can go to the CCU. You know, those are the things that I'll be saying to her. And those are the things that I'm telling her, I will tell her then.
Mm.
I told you that they will fix the heart for you, now they have fixed it. Now it's time for you to wake up and go home. So I'm just preparing her, because I know I will reach there. So when you get there, when I'm talking to her, she'll be knowing in her subconscious mind where she'll be. She'll know she'll have to fight to get out of this.
To get out, huh?
Yes.
I talk to Kenyans.
My appeal to all of you out there, my fellow parents, even if you're not a parent, please help us. Help us to save my Petra. I always call her my young warrior, because she's very strong. Please help us, whichever way you can help us, to make our transition to Chennai Miyot Hospital smooth. The operation is going to be done in Miyot International Hospital.
Where is that?
It's in Chennai, India.
Mm-hmm.
And the cost of everything is coming to about 2.5 million. The good thing is that NHIF is going to pay for us up to half a million.
Mm-hmm.
And then the rest we are trying to fundraise.
Mm-hmm.
We have like about 140,000 in our kitty. And now the balance is coming to almost like about 1.9.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, hence now my appeal to everyone out there.
Mm-hmm. If your daughter is watching you right now, what would you want to tell her?
I'll tell her that, you see, in this world, there are a lot of challenges. And if Petra is sick, you should be there for her as her mom. This can also affect you later on in life. When Petra realizes you were never there for her when she was sick. Right now, she knows nothing. And even if she dies and sees you, she's enjoying herself with her grandmother and her auntie. But later on in life, she may come and learn that you were never there for her when she was sick, and it'll come back to you negatively. You should learn how to approach problems as they come and deal with them.
Mm.
Otherwise, if I wasn't a brave mom, since the time she used to scream from at night and not gain weight and wake up with different colors, today she wakes up very brown, tomorrow she wakes up very black. If it wasn't me being a strong mom saying, no, I cannot allow this to happen, then we wouldn't be here by now. Even maybe Petra would have been long gone, because I would have said, no, take your burden, don't throw for me your burden, you know. But I stood by Petra.
Then come.
Mm-hmm.